Robin Ford has become simply one of the world's most recognized blues musicians. His superb and tasty guitar style is reinforced with an incredible depth in jazz and rhythm and blues. REH and CPP are very proud to welcome Robin back for his third video, a two-part series exploring the finer points of contemporary blues guitar playing, featuring his powerful trio, Roscoe Beck on bass and Tom Breckline on drums. Today in part one, Robin demonstrates rhythm playing and improvising ideas for both major and minor blues, along with an in-depth look at the song Living in a Fool's Paradise, a unique blues popularized by Robin and the band. We'll also talk with Robin about his return to playing blues and about his role in the trio.
Welcome to my third video for REH. It's a pleasure once again to be doing this. Always enjoy it. What we're going to do here in this particular video is try to bring together a couple of concepts, I guess you could say. The blues and on one hand, and the adventures of jazz harmony, and kind of bring them together in what we're doing right now with my own group, the Blue Line. There's been quite a musical journey that's happened over the last, I would say, 10 years in particular, exploring different kinds of music, and somehow I've wound back up with the blues, which I'm very happy about, because it's really where I started in terms of first inspirations to play the guitar in particular. So the band that I have right now, which includes Roscoe Beck on bass, Tom Breckline on drums, is kind of an example of the simplest possible setting in that we're a trio, and at the same time we're playing blues and a lot of other music forms with just these three guys. So there's this challenge that exists all the time. Which seems to have brought us all up to another level of putting all of our musical influences together. So hopefully you'll be able to see that journey coming together here in this video. So here we go. Okay, we're going to begin by taking a good look at rhythm playing, which is something a lot of people seem to want to put on the back burner. You know, everybody wants to be burning and playing a lot of guitar solos, but you really need to get a good foundation in chords, and working on your rhythm playing is going to strengthen everything about your musicality. So we'll begin with that. We'll get into single note playing. Against both the blues and chord changes. And of course, you're going to be seeing a lot of playing from the band. The Blue Line is here, and we'll play a few numbers for you together. But first, let me give you a note to tune up. Thank you. We're going to do something here with a real simple basic blues progression, and I'm going to demonstrate some rhythm work for you. One of the key elements in the blues in particular is, it's obviously kind of a simple basic form of music, not real complex. And it's wonderful. It's like the more you realize that that's a beautiful thing, you know, the more kind of joy that you get out of it. And a lot of fun in the blues, you know. And keeping things fairly simple and also keeping things somewhat repetitive actually creates this funkiness, you know, where everybody, you know, the player and the audience as well, can both get into it, you know. Just get into the feeling of it. So we're going to play a real simple, kind of a Latin mambo style feel here, and I'm just going to lay down some comps for you, and we'll talk about it a little bit more afterwards. One, two, three, four. So we just played a straight 12-bar blues there, key of G, and didn't go too far, I don't think, outside of just one, four, and five chords. So I'm going to talk a little bit about why I would even put the chords that I played together. The fundamental element which runs through anybody's comping work, no matter what their instrument or what they're up to, what style of music, you you want to have little things, and I mean the simplest of things that tie your chords together and whatever your comp is together. And so that means you have some kind of harmonic consistency and that you have some rhythmic consistency. In jazz, rhythmic consistency is a little less of a factor. Harmonic consistency is always there. So now we're talking about the blues, and for instance, I was playing this chord for my G chord at one point. Now, we don't have the bass player right now, but this chord is G13 add 9, at least that's what I call it. You've got your basic seventh chord, G7. The tonic, we're missing because the bass player would be playing it. Seventh, third, 13th or sixth, ninth, and the fifth. I love this chord. Okay, so I was playing it something like, let's say. Okay, now I know my next chord is going to be a C7 of some kind, right? We're talking about the blues here. So for my C chord, it's going to be some form of C7. So I'll play either a C7 add 9, or maybe C13 add 9. And we're keeping this note on the top, which sort of ties the two chords together, right? Back to the G. Now for my 5 chord, I'll play a D9. Once again, we keep this on top, you know, to keep this little, keep the chords all tied together nice and neat. I'm not moving too far away from any one voicing, you know, of the chords. So it creates this, you know, consistency that is what we're looking for here. I could be playing a G7. Right? Now my next chord is going to be a C7. I could play that voicing, but maybe I'd like to hear that voicing. So we have a C9 here. So now for the 5 chord, if I wanted to keep the same kind of idea as the what we were trying before, maybe I'll play a D11. So we're keeping the tonic consistent through all these chords. So now I'll play that for my 5 chord. Now an interesting little thing. Everybody does it, really, but I don't think they quite even know what they're doing. There's a tradition that's developed of making little half-step moves into chords. Whatever your next chord's going to be, a little half-step into it, right? You might go from, you know, the bottom up, or you might go from the top down. Now, I have a tendency to do it that way. You know, I'm going to make a half step from above into the chord that I'm playing. And there's a wonderful little thing that's going on there called a tritone substitution, which is always difficult to nail. And I know we've talked about it before in past videos, but it's a tough concept for people to get, and then one day they just sort of get it, you know. So if you play A7 going into G7, okay, so there's your 7th chord. Tonic 3rd, 7th. There's an A flat. Tonic 3rd, 7th. Now if you put a D in that, in the bass there, and play the A flat 7, basically what you've got is a D7 flat 5, which is a 5 chord, slightly altered 5 chord, right? You've flatted the 5th of the 5 chord. that's given you a legitimate 5-1 chord progression there. And it's harmonically very correct to do that. It's something that sort of, I think, developed just because it was easy, you know, to do. To get some kind of motion going on, and you don't really have to change much of what you're doing. But it's actually a very legitimate 5-1 chord progression you've just done there. Same thing happens here. Going from D-flat 7 to C7. You've just played an altered 5 chord, an altered 5-1 there, G being the 5 chord of C7. Really, the thing is, it sounds right. You know, whether or not you even understand it, it sounds right because it is right, you know? And so that's a nice little tool that you can use to get around the guitar. You know, that kind of a thing. Half step from one chord to another. Well, a lot of this video is going to be live footage of our band playing. And the song we're going to do here is an old Willie Dixon number called I Don't Play, which was recorded on Chess Records by Little Walter Jacobs. I found the thing by digging deep. We are always looking for those obscure little numbers, you know, that you haven't heard recorded by somebody else before. So this is one of them. This will probably be new to your ears.
Yeah.
We're going to play, Roscoe and I are going to play a little minor blues for you here right now. One of the interesting twists about it, and it's an often used technique in playing minor songs, or minor blues in particular. We're going to play this in A minor. And for a four chord, we're going to use an F7 instead of a D minor or even a D9. Beyond that, five chord is just a E raised 9, D minor 7, and back to the A minor. So we're just going to play this for a little bit for you. One, two, three. The rhythm that we were just playing was sort of inspired by something Herbie Hancock used to do a lot. There was a whole period in jazz that I think many of us refer to as like the Blue Note years, when Blue Note Records was recording a lot of music that was really, it might even have been the early fusion music, you know? Because what they were doing was playing very funky and simple songs, but they were jazz, great jazz musicians, and they were exercising some of this harmonic sophistication as well, you know. Herbie Hancock wrote a song called Watermelon Man years ago, which many of you may know. There was a song called Cantaloupe Isle, and I'm not sure which one that I was thinking of when we started playing this rhythm, but I think it was Cantaloupe Isle, something like that. like that, right? That was the basic rhythm. The chord we were using as a four chord, we were playing an F7. So at one point I had this little rhythm going that was like this. The five chord, right? Now that's a fun thing to hear when it happens, you know? You don't expect it. Right? I'm using basically the same chords out of each of those. This A minor. This is a D, B minor. Those two chords are virtually the same. To A minor. Now here we have, on the F7, C minor, B flat, F7. The key here is the four chord. This would be, for A minor, it's a D or B minor, which is the four chord of the thing. For the F7, the B flat is the four chord of F. Now this is a lot of words that basically are irrelevant. You know, the thing is, it sounds good. And the main reason for that is the harmony's tight, the rhythm is consistent, and there's this little element of surprise in there because, you know, your ear's not quite ready to hear that F7 instead of a D7. Now, another possibility here. A minor key has a relative, a major relative. Minor key has a major relative, and vice versa. Basically, the harmony of A minor is C major. They're virtually interchangeable. That's just the facts, you know? If you're playing in the key of A minor, you can play in the key of C major, and you're harmonically correct. Now you know. So you could play a C major chord with an A minor in the root. And what you've got now is an A minor 7, okay? Now, there's a lot of different voicings. You can play a C like that. You can play a C like that. You can play a C like that. Still have this A minor root, right? So every inversion of C major with an A in the root is going to give you an A minor 7 chord. Now I played a chord like this, which is basically a C major 7. Which is A minor 9. Here's the voicing I played. Once again, we don't have the bass with us right now, but I played this for an A minor 9. And I played that little thing in there at one point, which is nice because it goes sort of from major to minor. Now, this opened me up to the possibility of so that consistency in the harmony thing we were talking about. For the F, I could have just gone down here and played that, but far more interesting was to play that, which is basically an F9. Some of you may know that chord, with a flatted fifth. Very nice sound, huh? There's also this voicing, which we played earlier as the tonic chord in the key of G. Now this is an F, 13 add 9 with a flatted fifth on top. I could have played that. And again, you just have that consistency. You know? Some of the notes are remaining virtually the same, those two notes here. are not changing. But some of the others are, but they're not moving too far. And so you have a nice little thingy there. Let me show you some other possibilities. Let's say we're playing an F, A minor 7 right here. Now our next chord is going to be F 7, right? Our 4 chord. So do I go... No, I want to keep it close by, you know? There's a nice voicing. Once again, you have two notes that are not changing. The rest of the notes don't go far away. In fact, three notes. We have the A down here. Right? For the 5 chord, we could play that one. E, raised 9, raised 5th, or flatted 13th. And we have even more consistency going on here. And now we're going to play a D minor. So what D minor are we going to play? You know, do we go down here? Or even here? Well, you could, but to keep some kind of consistency going on, I played this D minor. D minor 9. However you want to play it. Here's another C major triad over an A minor root, which gives us A minor 7. Next chord is going to be an F 7. So we can play this voicing for the F. So you got, that's a B minor, C major over A. F. That's a good one. Now you're back to A minor. Now the point here is that it's actually not tough to play good rhythm guitar, you know? I mean, there's just a couple of real simple concepts here. You know, repetition and keeping these little notes that keep your chords tied together, you know? There's my 5 chord, there's my 4 chord, there's my 1 chord, right? All you gotta do is learn all these chords, and you can get them out of, you know, any number of books and videotapes. So just learn the chords, and then just see how they sound together. From there, you're just cooking, you know? It's just like cooking. You add, you know, certain things don't taste good together, you know? Certain things taste great together. It's the same with music. All you have to do is have the elements and put them properly in place, you know? So, I know that that's a good 5 chord here. So what's a good 4 chord, you know? I'm not gonna go... I mean, I could, but it's gonna jump out, you know? So that sounds wonderful. And I could even, you know, play that A minor 7. And this is like a little melody on top, kind of. Da, 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 da. Little teeny melody, you know, keeping your chords tight. Now we're going to take a look at this progression that we played a little bit earlier. It's the A minor, kind of a funky little blues thing, using an F7 as the 4 chord, and see what we might get out of that. First of all, we'll have the A minor 7, which is... That's the scale. Then we'll have this F7 chord. Now, you can approach it in different ways. Again, that F7 scale. something that it's tailor-made for is to use that F7 scale with the flatted fifth or raised fourth. Okay, and of course just your regular straight blues thingy, it's a key word here. And the other chord we're using here will be E raised 9. Once again, half diminished, half whole tone. Now we'll play this for you once again with Roscoe Beck on bass, Don Mock playing guitar with us here. And I'll see what kind of interesting notes I might come up with. One, two. Hey, you know what to do. This next number is a blues from Magic Sam, another obscure song that I hadn't heard until about 5 years ago, and that's having listened to a lot of blues records, so it was a wonderful find. It's called Bad Luck Blues. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, we have a thing, you know, like this little trio, we have a thing that I think it's something that you stumble across occasionally in your lifetime. You know, people, I mean, everybody wants to be in a good band. Every musician wants to be in a good band, you know, and all of us have worked for other people. This band, for me, I'm doing this because this is the band that I want to play with, you know. And it's a rare thing, you know. It's something that we all really value. You know, the relationship that happens, for whatever the reasons, is the right combination of elements. And it's a rare thing. So we all feel real fortunate, I think. The beauty of it is that it is still blues, you know. It's not like jazz guys trying to play the blues. That's not what's happening at all. I mean, we're playing that music for real. Otherwise, we wouldn't be messing around with it, you know. And as you say, we have this background in jazz, you know, that's also quite strong. So it just gives it a little bit of a freshness, you know, and a newness. That's kind of the beauty of the whole thing. We consider ourselves sort of a blues hybrid, you know. Now, Roscoe Beck and I are going to play a blues for you. It's an 8-bar blues with a bridge. It's got a lot more chord changes in it than your standard 12 bars. And it was written by a great blues man named Charles Brown, who wrote several classics, including Driftin' Blues, and this particular song called Living in a Fool's Paradise. And we're going to play, at first, play the chords for you, just so you get an idea of what the chords are, and then I'll do some single note playing over it as well. 3, 4. Thank you. Now we're going to play over these chords, this 8-bar blues form with some little extra twists and turns in it, and see if we can put together the straight blues feeling and also a little bit more adventurous harmonic twists. So here we go. Something like this. Two, three. So the first chord of this progression is an F13, and Don, give us an F13 here. The scale that goes over that chord is what I would call an F7 scale. It's a B-flat major scale starting on the fifth degree, which is F. Now also, of course, you have your basic blues scale, which most people break down to the pentatonic scale. Okay. I would include a couple of notes. Again, we've been through this on previous videos, but just to refresh, you can include also flatted fifth in there. And I think that about covers all the potential notes there, that F7 scale and the pentatonic and the flatted fifth. Okay, next chord is C raised 9, raised 5, like that. The scale that is played over that particular chord is, I believe you'd refer to it as half diminished, half whole tone, or melodic minor. Okay. Now, when I'm playing over this thing, sometimes I'll exercise liberties and treat it as an altered chord, but I might use this note. Instead of a raised fifth, I'll play the 13th. So it's raised 9, 13. And that would change the scale to basically half step, whole step scale, which is the diminished scale. It's just a series of half steps and whole steps. Half step, whole step, half step. Okay? So the first part of the tune is... Next chord is going to be a B-flat 11, and then we go to a B-flat 13, flat 5. You may notice some similarities in this song to I Ain't Got Nothing But the Blues, which we went through on my last video. It's got this same little turnaround on the 4 chord. The B-flat 11, which is basically just a regular diatonic scale, B flat 7. Then we alter it to the flatted fifth, 13th chord. So we just add the flatted fifth, raised 11th actually, is probably the better way of putting it. Then it goes to B flat minor. Same B flat 7 scale with a minor third instead of a major third. And then it basically just goes E flat 7, E 7, F 7, and those are just seventh chord scales. We do a little thing in here, my favorite chordal trick, keeping some kind of consistency in those chords. This is my E-flat chord, E-flat 13, add 9. E-13, flat 9, to F-13. Okay, let's see. The next chords are simply a series of kind of two fives. E flat 7, B flat 7, E flat 7, D raised 9, and that raised 9 is the same as the C. And play. Next one, D flat raised 9, plus 5. We've been through that scale. To C, same chord. F7, C raised 9. Now, one thing you can do here with that series of turnarounds. Basically just a series of seventh chords going down in half steps. Now, in playing these in this way, one thing you want to do. First one's an E-flat, an F7. Now the next one being B-flat 7, flat 5, or plus 11. So that's going to be important in the scale that you're using to play over that chord. You've got an F7 here, B-flat 7, raised 11th, or flat 5, E-flat 7, A-flat 7, flat 5, D-flat 7, G-flat 7, flat 5, F. So it's one thing to play these things and just play the blues going down in half steps. You can do that. It's got a certain effect. So let's do it that way. We'll play those things in these two different ways. D, 4. Okay? Now that has a certain effect. And that it's important to understand that to play it that straight blues on every one of those chords is intentional. You know, it's not just that you don't necessarily know what else to do. And that's what gives it its power. You know, if you know that you have some other alternatives, but you're just going to play the blues, you know, on every one of those chords, it gives it impact. So the next way to go is doing it as sort of two fives. So it goes like this, 3, 4. So the approaches are different, you know, with one of them you're coming at it in a more interesting way harmonically, and that creates a certain atmosphere and a certain tension of its own. And then when you just play the straight blues, that creates a certain atmosphere and a certain tension. So, you know, the element that makes it a musical experience and an interesting or a good one or a better one is that, you know, you have this knowledge, but you do it intentionally. So you mean to create a different feeling, you know? You want to kind of make people go, oh, that's interesting. You know, you're giving them something that their ears can get sort of excited about for a minute. And the next minute you're playing something just all, you know, heart and soul, you know. So there's this little musical journey that's going on. And again, it's done intentionally. It's not just, you know, the other side of it is, I know how to play this interesting scale, so I'll play this interesting scale, you know. The fun of it is, you know, that you're actually playing with it in an emotional way. So that's real important. One thing with the blues is you got to love the blues, you know. The blues isn't just a form, you know, a thing. It's got meaning to it, you know. And you really have to love it. I've worked with a lot of musicians, man, who, you know, like, they like it, you know. They go, oh, yeah, we'll play some blues, you know. That's not it. You know, you need to really love the music in order to actually understand how to play it and how to play with it and everything. So, and I think that love for blues could come on various levels. It might just be, you know, you heard it for the first time, it knocked you out and you got into it. But there were certain forms of blues that I didn't even really care for when I first heard it, that I've grown to love more and more as time has gone by, you know. So you got to go through it, you know, get into it and go through it to come out the other side with it, you know.
Hey. My mother told me, my father said it too. He said, son, fate's gonna catch right up with you. You keep on drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise. My mother told me, my father said it right. He said, son, you're gonna drop right out of sight. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise.
Well, with singing and playing rhythm guitar, doing these two things at the same time, there are moments where it gets kind of complex. And really, I've found that if I just go ahead and do it, you know, play the part, sing the part, eventually I start working it out. And the rhythm part might change a little bit to accommodate my own singing. But it's actually kind of like chewing gum and walking at the same time. If you just do it. But a lot of what I do is sing, play something, sing, play something. There are fewer songs in the set where I'm kind of doing both at the same time. Or if I am, it's something real repetitive, you know, just something simple that I don't have to think about too much. Just like a folk singer doing this, only I'll be doing something with my fingers, generally, you know.
Yeah, it's just living.
This concludes part one of Back to the Blues with Robin Ford. Don't miss part two as Robin continues demonstrating contemporary blues concepts, including comping and soloing for a swing blues and a one-chord blues vamp, in addition to a special section on right-hand techniques. We'll also hear from Robin as he talks about how to be more melodic, his guitars, influences, and getting a good sound. And we'll see more powerful performances from Robin Ford and the Blue Line. So on behalf of Robin Ford, REH, and CPP, thanks for joining us, and we'll see you in part two.